Good morning, everybody. My voice audible?
Yes.
Okay. I am Poonam with over 15 years of experience in different fields. So I have started my career as a developer, shifted into consulting for transformation of the projects, transformation of people, and also being part of implementation of lean using different methodologies like Scrum. Then doing, say, Kanban, a part of the maximum of the Scrum, and then now implementing the Scale Agile framework for the organization. So helping teams get transformed, both from a project perspective, and the topic that I would be representing is primarily from even the mindset perspective. So that's a very brief introduction, but as a part of my passion, I also work on understanding the aspects of an individual person, so that helps us implement the work that we're doing within the project. So like, because the mindset is the key aspect in any work or anything that we do. So that's the other aspect of things. So today's session would be focused more on the mindset in an organization, because that's one of the key aspect of things. If you don't have the right mindset, as we were discussing, if we don't have the support from the stakeholders, so if we don't have the right mindset coming in from the management or from the stakeholders, nothing can be done. And it's not only applicable in an organization, but even in our day-to-day life, if there isn't the right mindset, we cannot achieve things of what we want. So that's what would be the session, but again, we are in the Discuss Agile event. So it would be more of discussion than just me talking about it. Otherwise, it's just going to be, I don't think it would be a discuss. It will be a one-way discuss. Then next time onwards, maybe Giri will start writing that it should be a two-way discuss agile event rather than one-way. So we'll try doing. So I would expect you guys to participate more. And it's nothing like a rule that this is what is right and this is what is wrong. Everything is context-driven. I am a strong believer of that. Everything is a context-driven aspect in the things that we do. Just taking an example, you would see my hand, there's how much you feel that it's too much, right? But yes or no?
Yes or no?
That's a context, but at least, okay, considering me, you find this to be better.
So I can come there and they can compare and find out.
Yes, that will also help. Then they let you.
Or they can send him.
Yeah. Give him. I'm the best one.
Yeah. Do you want us to stand as well so they can see the extreme?
If you're asking us from a personal perspective, then certainly we can comment.
Yes.
But suppose if you're representing some shampoo organization, manufacturing shampoo and all that, and you're trying to sell it, then we need to think about it.
Okay, so then I'll get that clarified. It's from the perspective, I'm not doing any advertisement out here for any shampoo or for any product. But just in person, okay, the moment you see, for example, if you see Giri, you will say, Giri, he has got a little less. Or if you see the other person, say, oh, as compared to him, he has much more. And as compared to him, I may have a little more. Right? Or if I just take, if I assume now it's much more, and if I just take this, you can see, you can see it, right? If I cut this and put it in Giri's tea, will he drink the tea?
No.
Because in that context, this hair is something which is much more. He would not even have it. So everything is context driven. So similarly, the things that we would want to implement in our organization or in our day-to-day life is also a context driven aspect of things. So nothing right, nothing wrong. So I would just this is what is going to be at a high level what I have thought I would want to explain as a part of this session. Where we talk about what a mindset is, and taking in continuation to what we saw in our previous session, the traditional versus scale agile and then lean agile, and there is one of the framework that I have found good. How many of you have heard about the switch framework or have read the book The Switch? None? Then that makes my life easier. Because I was just wondering, if somebody has already read about it, then I need to be much more prepared. But at least I can introduce this concept of the switch framework of mindset change. That's really a wonderful book with a lot of good examples that talks about how to bring a switch or change the mindset of people, and it can be from anything. So it is also one of the recommended books in the Scaled Agile framework. This helps you to understand how you can switch the mind from a waterfall to an agile. And not only on this, I think over the tea we were just talking about I work with Tieto and I'm in Karari Eon, and we were just talking about that if I stay almost 26 kilometers away from the office. So we were talking about, okay, if I have to travel, how it is, and do we really have that much of, and a lot of more companies are shifting there. So do we really have that much of the infrastructure for people to travel there on time and come back on time? So that was one of the discussion, and I overheard a few of the discussion here where people were saying that traveling to Hinjawadi is another headache. Because again, when you travel to Hinjawadi, I think more than going to office, we all are worried about traveling itself only. Okay. Oh my God, it's so much of a commute aspect of things. So maybe these things that we're going to talk about would actually help us shift our mindset even while we're traveling. Okay. So the switch framework can be applied anywhere, any point of time in your life, as an individual, as a group, as an organization, as well as in your families and also. That's a very generic framework to be applied across. So we'll be talking about it as well. Okay. So before I get into maybe the things, I need to understand from the group, what would you define a mindset as?
Your beliefs.
Beliefs, right?
Your inner instinct.
So we would have belief.
Faith.
What
is it? Faith. What do you?
Faith, if I may. And we had inner instincts.
Way of thinking.
Perspective. Biases.
It's knowledge also.
Biases.
Best practices.
Perspective.
I would call it a fear factor.
Fear factor.
Yes. Culture.
Culture.
Core values.
Okay.
Bureaucratic.
Anything that.
Perspective of thinking.
Perspective of thinking. It is.
It is time driven.
Time driven. Everything you are right is definitely time and context driven.
Right.
And I think that's the key principle in even in the mindset change perspective, that you need to really understand the context and then come to the conclusion aspect. So I think anybody agrees, disagrees to whatever has been listed out here. Any agreements, disagreements on
the session is faith, not faith.
Yeah.
Sorry. Faith. Anything else? So I just wanted to make sure that we all understand what actually a mindset means. Because many times what I have seen in my practical implementation of Agile, we talk about mindset. But people actually really don't understand when you are asked to change your mindset, what does that actually mean? You're asked to do something, but it's just like following somebody has told me. And especially if you have junior members in your team, the focus is like, okay, because my manager has told, I need to do something. And we keep complaining. I'm assuming all of you have worked or are working in an agile environment.
Yes.
Yes, right?
Somewhat true.
Somewhat true. A little explanation of that. Somewhat.
We are in
transformation. Are we seeing probably we can come in and have to do this? And the committee will switch in. That's definitely possible. Switching to the network. Most of the others will have that switches.
That's absolutely right. And you're right in that aspect. Not everybody is doing the true agile. Most of us are already in the transformation stage. Or many times we just use the terminologies of agile. That's okay, I do scrum. I would say that most common terminology is the daily stand-up meetings. So if I'm doing a daily stand-up meeting and I have used these scrum terminologies, like a scrum master and all, then I am agile and my mindset has changed to agile. That is what is the practical things which we have seen implementation, and you decide it, right? Yes, and that's right. Maybe some inputs that you can provide.
I can say that just using the terminology in your work environment or anywhere, just use it. That's not in the sense, unless and until you adopt those philosophies and implementations.
Right.
How about me for like, I mean, big transformation project. So here, not many requirements are not known, right? So you have to do a kind of an incremental approach to get the things done. So they have been developing key stakeholders, at times we are saying that no, they are not interested, they are not participating. So, what are the ways? So, we just try to figure it out what is their mindset, try to cope there, understand what is the output of that, go to the next level. I can go just try to bring it. So, once they are coming in, they feel that okay, so this is good. And the kind of a clearly poking actually
matters a lot, that's right.
So, that's what we are just following. Mm-hmm. And we are not using any kind of that agile terminology of the scrum meeting or daily standard meeting, whatever you say. But yes, the philosophy is getting
implemented. That's absolutely right. And I think that's the right approach, because the key aspect is definitely that when we are talking about a mindset, rather than using just the terminologies, the key thing that has to be done, the philosophies have to be implemented, right? How many of you believe that doing daily exercise and eating healthy is good for us, good for your own health, forget about others? How many of you
believe?
Okay, we have people. I'm just asking how many of you believe that this is what is there. You believe, right?
Probably everyone believes, but most of them.
Most of them don't do that, right?
Apply no.
So we believe. We understand that it is really important, but we don't. Or we have, I would say, a lot of us, if we start sitting and writing, we might come up with 1001 reasons of not following these things, because we always have one or the other excuse. And that again is associated with our own mindset that we have built in for ourselves. So I think the key aspect is definitely the easiest definition, which is there. The ideas and attitudes with which a person approaches a situation, especially when these are seen as being difficult to alter. So that's a key aspect in a mindset, and definitely when we are trying in an agile environment, when we are trying to switch people from waterfall to an agile, it becomes very difficult, because as you were mentioning about that, yes sir, we need to keep poking people to tell them that, okay, this is the philosophy that you should apply. And you would also,
if you say that, they would never take it. So you have to tactically inculcate that.
Yes.
And with a key stakeholder, say probably customer and customer.
Right.
So you have to bring them on and ask that, okay, so what is your problem and what will make? So that time probably we need to express, so I'm just getting this study because it is going to be that.
So
you start looking to some very next thing to say, because I have found out such a solution. So probably you can try it. So like that, it's a
It's more about poking them to get the response from there itself. That's right. So I think, how many of you follow this kind of things within your own organization? Trying to inculcate this kind of a mindset where you would want the people themselves to, or the stakeholders, at least in this case, to come up with their own solutions. Okay. We have 1, 2, 3. Most of you try to get the solutions from the stakeholders itself.
My approach is slightly different. I have also been involved in these kind of transmissions. I normally don't introduce the jargons in the first place. I try to get into the philosophies and get the things done, but using the same jargons probably because they're more used to that. And
right.
Eventually I get them introduced and make them realize that actually we're doing Agile, see, for the last 3 months. And then they realize, oh, actually we're doing Agile, I never knew. I said, yes,
that's right, so you're just trying to change their habit or
yes.
change their
yeah.
behavioral patterns.
Yes, first change and then bring the jargon. Because I've normally seen when you introduce the jargons in the first place, people are too boggled and they're very resistant.
And they would have that thought like,
yes,
okay, something, block. Another...
They have
some
blockers
some
in mind and they just shut them. They just
right.
shut those.
I think in many situations, these are natural processes like intricateness, which you talk about Agile, that
yeah.
has to be there. So if someone has some challenge, some impediment, so people come together, they discuss, they try to sort it out. You name it as, you know, like
yeah.
Agile or
you name it
impediment
what
and whatever not. So only it's like naturally it happens, and if you believe in that naturalness, getting people involved, then certainly you get solutions
that's
faster.
And I think... So most of you are already getting that into the frame of the mindset change. So the reason why I'm asking these things is to let you guys know that definitely it is all about how you change the perception of individuals in your organization. That can be right from the junior team members to the top management. But this perception change has to happen throughout in the organization to get the scale level of the transformation. We are talking here more in terms of the agile environment, and it is not specifically only in an agile, but in any environment, this is what is really required to bring in the change. So a few of these things could also be touched upon when we talk about the switch framework. But then, yes, as I said, especially when you are in a difficult situation, if you want to alter the way you have to work things, you really need a mindset change. Just a small thing that I would want this group to do is you have to use your hands, and I just want to see how many of you would be doing. Do this, do this, do this, do this. And how quickly can you do it? You're able to do?
Yes.
Do this. How quickly you're able to do it? How many of you are confused still or not able to do? You're confused? I'm just saying that use your first finger thumb and then this, your finger and then this. So just try with, you can first try doing it with seeing and then try without seeing.
You mean motor skills?
No, I'm just trying to find out how. And then if I bring a small change saying that instead of using this finger, use your next finger and try doing, how quickly you would be able to switch from here. You're able to?
Yes.
And if you move into the next, you're able to still do it?
Yes. Sure.
Yes. And the next, last one also you're able to. So how many of you are able to switch this easily, quickly? Everybody? No? How many of you were not able to do that? So we have a few people who are not able to do that. This is again associated with our own self about the practice or the effort that we are putting in. So people who are easily able to adapt to the things, we're able to quickly do it and then switch. At times, we have certain blocks in ourselves saying that we are not able to do it and we don't even give a try. Or we do give a try and then we're like, it's okay. This is something very small kind of a thing and you may not do it. So these are certain aspects or attitudes which start building up in an individual, in an organization, or even in ourselves, which create a lot of blockages to help implement things at a larger scale. So for example, if I have created a block, I'm not able to do it. I just go to the next person and say, yeah, I'm not at all able to. But if I'm able to convince him that I'm not able to do it, he will also get convinced she cannot really do it. But he'll not even take the efforts to explain me here, it's very simple. Just do 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2 and you'll be able to do that. But maybe, slowly and gradually, what is going to happen is, I'm going to spread this across to everybody saying, here, this person cannot do it. Or I cannot do it. So what is happening is I'm building that perception, I'm building that cloud of, I cannot do it with everybody. So tomorrow, if anybody is trying to even come and explain me even a smaller thing, they already have that block saying that she is a person who really cannot understand anything. So we really don't know how to take up, or do we really need her to be here? Let's move her out and bring somebody else. Because why telling this all these things is because in an agile environment, the concept is that you need experts to be there in your team, and you need experts, and that is only then you will be able to deliver things faster. And in practical terms, what I have seen is, even when you go to the customers, they say that, okay, we need people with 6 to 7 years of experience in this agile team, because they feel that if there is a number of years of experience attached, the person will be able to deliver faster. That's again a mindset. Even if I have a person who has 20 years of experience but has never worked on it, will still not be able to deliver it. But just using the terminologies and things would not help. So again, this is a mindset shift that we would want to bring within our own team as well as with the customer. But even before going to the customer, bringing the mindset change within my team, saying that even if you get a person with 1 or 2 years of experience but has the capability to do it, let's start doing it. Or even if you have a person with X number of years of experience and can do it, let's start utilizing them. So there would be certain things that we would be talking in the switch framework, and then I would also give it. How many of you have seen Kung Fu Panda 3 or Kung Fu Panda movies? Most of you. So I think that would also be, while I'm talking about the switch, you might be able to relate it to this movie, because I found that movie to be really one of the movies that you should showcase to your teams, definitely. Because it has got very powerful messages for the teams to understand, and I hope they would enjoy the movie as well and understand and grasp the messages from the movie. Yeah. So moving on to the next part, traditional versus scale. Now when we're talking about here from a traditional perspective, it is again the waterfall versus the agile team. So I think more than me talking about this, people who are part of this game, the earlier game changer, should be able to provide me more input. So I will not talk more on this, but you guys will have to tell me what is your understanding. Let's go with the traditional mindset.
It's rigid.
Rigid? So here is the traditional, here is the scale. Rigid?
So, from traditional perspective, as the roles have been defined, they are performing in that roles per se.
Okay.
But in the expectation and scale would be different. So, I don't see there would be a difference from the team perspective, because they have been asked to do certain things and they are doing those things from that perspective. So, they are still doing teamwork, they are still working as a team. And whether you are asking them to do in traditional or in scale, it would be a similar line.
Okay. How many of you agree and disagree with him? You were able to hear, right?
Yeah.
So you agree or disagree?
I disagree.
Yeah. Okay, this part is completely disagree. So this, was this a waterfall team? And okay, so pointers of why do you disagree?
I think traditional, the focus was more on individual performance. The team concept never got evolved.
Okay,
people were more focused on, okay, this is my area, I can do, I'm an expert, I'll deliver, and that was there. In the, in the other way, it is more of the teamwork that is coming up, and so even if somebody is not really doing well, the entire team goes ahead to help him to come up so that as a team they succeed, and that is something that we really see. Yeah.
Seeing this.
Yes.
But then wasn't that what the expectation for the scale team or the agile team? You put down an expectation at the beginning that you have to
do. Expectation,
team
is
team.
Expectation
is
when
something.
You are doing traditional, it is more of command and control.
Yes.
Mindset. But in scale, it is more of collaborative and succeed.
Yeah.
So that's a jargon, right?
No, that's not the jargon. That's not the jargon. That's the, you know, that's the mantra.
Before agile team, teams were working together and they were delivering as a team.
You can always, you know, argue that that's what the role given to me, I will do only this thing. And then the team will fail.
You know, in traditional, you will see people would be like, after 4 or 5 years of experience, everybody would be striving to move to that team lead position. Okay.
Yes.
So everybody, the individual performance becomes really, and organizations were also awarding, or the rewards and everything was so defined, the appraisal process, whatever you say, the entire organizational thought process or the policies were very much focused towards individual performance or individualism, I would say.
So that's how even the teams groomed up. So they, although they're performing as a team at the bottom level, but at the back of this thing too, that I should go ahead, yeah, I should go ahead,
So just a question over here, and you brought a very good point. The appraisal system is really the key thing. Yeah,
has it changed?
That's what my question is. Has it really changed?
No.
How many of you are
changing now?
In any organization, appraisal has been changed because Agile has been brought in.
Day zero, everybody was following certain appraisal process. Day one, everybody has changed.
Okay.
Because the mindset is changing.
Yes, people are implementing.
It is changing, but again, I'm just telling, bell curve was there in the previous years. It is still there today.
No,
and it's there. Most of the companies have gone on.
How many of you have implemented if agile environment has changed? So, can you give example of how you have?
Absolutely. So, as this gentleman, this person said, it's slowly evolving. It was not like we finished waterfall model today and tomorrow we got into Agile. It evolved like the same way.
Yeah.
Appraisals had also taken turns from the past. And slowly there are big companies who have done away with the bell curves. And slowly they are moving into Agile appraisals because their company, their accounts, their customers have got into Agile.
Yes.
And that we have a different way of assessing people and a different way of stack ranking them and again trying to push Agile appraisals already. I mean, big companies in India have already done away with bell curves.
So anyways, if we are talking about the change in the Agile and everything with the HR policies and everything, but yes, net, the pay and everything remains the same.
We are not talking about pay, but we are talking about appraising the effort. So compensation is different from your performance. That you can't resolve. Everybody is going to say, I work more, I get paid less. So even though the metrics have changed now, considering these things.
Pay will remain the same. Your daily sweat will remain the same.
So, are we saying that previously in waterfall there were no successful deliveries, and in Agile now we are delivering successfully? Because team mindset. Are we saying that?
No.
In Agile.
Teamwork was there previously. I worked in waterfall. I worked in Agile.
I would never say heroism. I actually saw many heroes and outstanding used to work extensively. There is nothing to say that Agile in waterfall no projects were delivered successfully. Yes. But the heroism was here and is there. That the person who is capable has this Agile mindset somewhere in within used to make sure that my team performed.
Exactly.
But it's not that. What we are saying, Agile framework supports that it naturally comes up as effective and more concrete to the delivery. It's not out of the way, I have to go monitor and say this guy is not performing and I have to just hold that one. So everybody as a team care and bothers about the delivery. So that mindset and heroism to the team efforts is something that coming up in Agile.
But that has been asked to do, right? Now we have put team as an ownership for delivery.
Who asked? That's what I'm saying. You have asked the team. Ownership has been given to the team.
Initially, the ownership was with the project manager that he needs to make sure that it has to be delivered. Now the ownership has gone to team. That team needs to make sure that the delivery has to happen.
Exactly. That's what we are talking about. This is what the waterfall is.
It
all starts with your business case. If the business case supports the waterfall, then you go with the waterfall. If it supports the, if your competition is high, if you are working in the UCA world, then you need to go with the agile. That's simple as it. Every project cannot be, some projects would be there,
you can't go agile in them. There would be stakeholders who would be against that. Some people would be against decentralizing control rather than holding that. I am the one who would give the work to the team. Why is the team taking responsibility? I am the one who would make sure that this project will happen and I will succeed, I will move to that next step. So decentralizing control is one of the biggest funda of Agile. You don't have to control. Remove that control from that one person, move it to individuals who are basically at the ground level working hard to make it successful.
But I'll tell you, if it's decentralized, I think that comes down from the smart process of decentralizing the decision making. So if you allow people to think of themselves, even if you do it at your personal level, if you allow your child to think for themselves, you will see he will come up with something different which you may not have thought.
And actually, that freedom is there.
Yes.
And what you're saying is also right. It is not something that a waterfall model was never successful, and that is why it has come. It's again the terminologies and the jargons which are used.
Right.
Tomorrow, I may come up with something like a Poonam methodology, which might be a combination of all of these, and I would say I picked up the best of everything, and now you guys should start following Poonam methodology because that's the best in the world.
Market it well.
Yeah, I take help from everybody here to market that. Maybe I'll use the Discuss Agile.
That's when we will come and get certified.
Yeah, and I utilize Discuss Agile and Eisenbridge to market it much more.
Right.
So what I think the key aspect again is every time a new yeah.
So what significance does it make to a developer or a tester, irrespective of applying, I mean, following any of this methodology? For him, he has to go about.
He still has to.
No.
See,
ownership has changed.
See, the ownership will change, or the things will change. But again, why I brought this point in the discussion was primarily because if you notice, whatever you follow, whatever you do, it is again. Your mindset should be right. If I think that I have to deliver quality, I will deliver quality. I don't need somebody to tell. Okay, how many of you cook?
Stories.
Very
have. How many of you cook stories?
Okay, I would say how many of you cook food? Even cooking stories is fine. How many of you raise hands? Okay, let me ask this gentleman. What was the first food that you cooked?
Tea.
How was it? Did everybody like it?
No, me liked it.
Okay, you liked it, so you just had it. The first experience that anybody would want to share, don't tell me the first time you cooked everything was really very tasty and everybody liked it.
No, actually first time I prepared chapati. So that was on Sarita. My friends were coming. And I was able to make the shape of the chapati like India.
Okay, wow.
Not like round, yeah. And it was half-baked.
Half-baked.
So nobody was ready to eat it.
So did you have it?
I have to.
You had to. Okay. That was a force of having it. Any other experience of...
One again. I was trying to make poha along with my friend, so it was some sort of teamwork. But then it was my experiment with the poha for the first time. We ended up making a poha laddu.
Poha laddu.
But then it was a team effort. And yes, the taste was pretty much okay. So since it was a teamwork, everyone liked it. So it's something I thought it was a force or something
like that. Something like that. You like it. The reason again why I'm asking is because what happens is, yes, he was forced to eat it. Because he had cooked it. But if tomorrow a friend or somebody at your family would have given you that, would you have had it? No. Right? So again, this is a mindset. Because I am a customer, I want quality from you. I am a customer, I want quality from you. I cannot even do this much of adjustment. It's okay. If you don't give me, if it is half baked, I'll still have it. But when I cooked it, I am a supplier. But what am I expecting my customer? You please have here. I have spent so much of efforts. It's almost 1.5 hours I'm trying to do something and I cooked it. So at least value the efforts that I have put in and have something. We say, na, so at least just to make me happy, you try to do it. So the perception immediately changes because my role has changed. So similarly, what we are trying to say is, traditional also worked, Agile is also working. Tomorrow something else may come, it would also work. We have Scrum, we have Kanban, we have Scaled Agile, and maybe many much more permutation and combination. But how do you see that is important? If I see it from a customer perspective, then irrespective of whether I'm following waterfall, I'm following Agile, I'm following Scale, I'm following Kanban, my focus of quality will always be there. It's only maybe the time or the method of doing it may vary. So the key thing again is you need to make sure that your mindset and your team's mindset and mindset of the people changes. It doesn't change based on the role that you're playing. If I'm a customer, I expect quality, but if I'm a supplier, it's okay, 1,000 pieces may one defect is okay. So I will, when this is my first, it's a defective piece, you please buy it, but the next 9,999 would be perfect. But then again, the next time you do, this is a little better, but less defective, so please have it. So we need to make sure that that doesn't happen. And again, most of you did talk about it. Traditional mindset focused on an individual as a leader, trying to give the command and control to one person. So as we talked about, project manager was being given the command. Maybe we say too many cooks spoil the food. So maybe somebody learned from that and said, ki if I have everybody in the team doing everything, my project may not get delivered properly. So they would have appointed a project manager as a role and saying that okay, he is responsible and he has to control the team. Again, somebody found a fault with that, saying ki, okay, this one person has got a lot of limitations. I should have multiple leaders. So again, going back to that, if I have multiple folks,
there's a difference. Managers are managers, leaders are leaders. Yeah. Project managers are more managers and not leaders.
Yes, but then with the change in the mindset.
Yeah, that.
Yes, with the change in the mindset, the expectation is your manager. I mean, so your manager should also be a leader, because if I move into scaling things, I cannot differentiate that I have one manager and then I have one leader. And then both the manager is working on the right side and the leader is going on the left side and my team is confused, where do I go? Yes, theoretically we do have a lot of good books talking about managers and leaders and you should become a leader, but in my own practical experiences of implementation of projects, everybody should follow or get into the path of being a leader. And everybody has that quality. It's only that we are not able to do it, or we are not willing to do that, just because I might be given additional responsibility if I do something or if I proactively start doing things. That is the biggest fear.
They are not allowed to do it.
Yeah?
They are not allowed to do it.
You may get the permission as well. If you see, at least in my own practical experiences, what I have seen is if you have showcased me and you are able to do it, everybody would be willing to come and tell you, "Ye le mera bhi kaam kare, come. Take this and do my work as well." And then people get into that mindset that if I do good, everybody starts dumping work upon me. I don't know how many of you have faced this situation.
A lot,
right? I think that's the perception that we all have, that if I do the work good, then everybody will start dumping it upon me and then I'm just nowhere. So that's again a mindset, and that's why we are saying that you need to move from focusing from an individual to everybody in your team. Again, the perception or mindset of that not everybody can become a leader is something which I don't believe in. How many of you would agree?
Sorry, come
again? I'm saying that there is generally perception that everybody cannot be a leader, and I don't believe in that.
So how do you define leadership? Is that what it works, right? Managers are essentially the leaders as well, because managers
do
all the things, get things done. Leader is a very buzzword nowadays. Everybody
and that's why I'm also using that buzzword.
Yeah. I think so anybody define leadership, what is meant by leadership, and how it differentiates from a manager?
See, by default, everybody can be a leader, as you already said. I mean, it need not be you having titles or team to lead or anything. So, the simple example is, I mean,
for me,
I don't know how many
would be like taking the ownership of the task and take it to the completion. So if he does that, he can be a leader. So and show that independence and interdependence.
That's right. And again, as you rightly said, that definition and that understanding has to be clear with everybody. When you say a manager, what you actually mean, and when you say a leader, what you mean. So what I'm trying to bring out in this whole discussion is that in your own projects, in your own organizations, or in whatever environment you're working into, make sure that you clearly define what you mean. Yes.
Do you think leadership means only owning something and doing it in the beginning and done?
No.
Leadership, my thought process about leadership is not only doing things but also taking people along with you.
Yes.
Enabling people to grow. So that's where I think not everybody can be good leaders.
So it's the ability to take everybody along with you.
A manager, not every manager can be a
leader.
A leader is someone who grows one step ahead and takes his team or managers to the next level. So not every manager. That is where traditional mindset and scaling mindset comes. In traditional mindset, a manager will not think that he can empower his team members to that level where he should. But in scaling mindset, when there are different leaders, most of them will ensure that his leadership team or his team can have that empowerment to take decisions, to do things on their ability and on their scalability. But in traditional mindset, I don't think so. And we working for so many years, I think we are slowly moving to this wherein people are trying to, okay, if you're giving me this, I need to be the owner, I am responsible, I need to be the decision maker. So there is where that is where scaling mindset is evolving slowly and steadily.
I think in my experience, in earlier model, like I saw Waterfall also, traditional management system, those managers were highly experienced and typically they not only able to implement day-to-day things, but they were able to give direction also. A leader is a person who actually senses direction, gives the team right direction. He has that insight naturally. So earlier it was the case. Now it may not be the case, because if you see the IT organizations are growing, many people, they have, everyone wants to become manager one day, but they may not have that kind of, experience and that kind of attitude. So the leader word is now coming up, leadership. You cannot have a management title for that, but you have ability to give a direction.
Yes.
For example, when we are talking about Agile in Scrum, we talk about empiricalness. That means you have that experience with you. You learned over a period. So those teams who learn over a period, they can also give direction. So whatever work you do, how best you are doing, that is decided by your leadership capability. So that's what difference I observe.
Yeah, so it's very important to become a good leader first. Management skill is something which can be bought up and pick up. So it's very important to have a good leader, because you have to lead by example. And that's right.
It actually recalls me, I don't know how many of you have read the book by Ravin Sharma, the leader who had no title. It clearly says, don't think that I have to develop so many things because I want to be a leader, I want to be a manager, I think. As long as you have a passion of whatever you are doing, you're giving that commitment and focus, and you're open enough to collaborate and share what you are doing, so then you are a leader.
That's right. And I agree with you. That will be one of the key aspects which I would say that when we are trying to move or scale into Agile, we should have these kind of sessions with the teams to help them understand what it is and how it is.
Right.
The only reason why I said that not everybody can be a leader, I don't agree with it, because everybody has the capability to do it.
Right.
The only thing is it is not explored. We need the right set of an environment, we need the right set of guidance to get those things explored. Because as I said, and we are talking about that, everything is context driven. In a particular situation, if it's a life threatening situation which comes in, automatically your skills of leaders or your skills of things start coming in, where you start looking out for things of how you would manage. And if you are say with your close ones or you're with your loved ones, then you try finding out ways of making sure that you are secure and your whole family is secure. So that,
even if you see in Pune, I recently moved back to Pune. I see so many leaders in breaking traffic signals. You stand in the traffic signal, somebody is a leader to break the traffic signal. So they are leaders in that
we
respect.
Actually, right?
They are
we follow actually.
People yeah, follow. There are leaders who break the traffic signal, and then there are followers.
Followers follow that.
Right?
So that's
why it's also true. There are leaders who follow and there are
stop
people
who stop behind.
So then they have no option.
And there are people who are leaders who say, no, I will not move till that signal turns green.
Right.
And there are leaders who break the traffic signal. So they are leaders.
And there are people who get influenced because somebody is honking continuously, and then you are like, hey,
let's become
disturbing that me, let's break it out also.
Yeah.
So that's for
so that is an environment basically.
That's
if there is a command and control from top, you have to follow command and control till end.
That's right.
So it is just like if you have 50 bus behind you,
You never know when it is
going to be. Forced leader, that's what she's saying, right? You need to explore that.
Yeah, so that's why I said, okay, you have those capabilities depending on the environment and situation. You may bring in your managerial skills or you may bring in your leadership skills.
Yeah, that's actually one of the topic we were discussing.
Yeah.
So though we call agile teams and all, you may have a very nasty team member. You know, so your team is ensuring to keep that person in team and trying to ensure get the best out of. Till if things are not working, somebody in the ladder or you know whatever has to make sure that this doesn't fit in. He or she has to change.
Right.
So unless he or that person has the authority to pass on that message, things may not change. So
that's right. And the other thing is also, and the reason why, taking that as an example, the reason why I was asking about the Kung Fu Panda thing is primarily because, if you remember, the panda builds his own team, right?
Right, yes.
And how does he build his own team?
Based on their, their
based
strengths.
On their own strengths. So, I think that is the key aspect, because as a leader or as a manager, whatever you term it as, we have a perception of the person is nasty or the person is not doing things, but we are not sure of why
right.
and how. But if I am able to figure out that this is the
right.
strength of this person and I should utilize it,
right.
I think I will be able to change the whole environment. But that does not happen. Because I have built that perception, and if my manager has built that perception, then my team will automatically start saying that, yes, this person will definitely not perform. The way I said,
right.
if I say that I cannot really do anything, and I build that perception, tomorrow, whether he knows me or not, but he'll say, okay, I have heard that she cannot do it, and she'll not work. So that's how it will change. So what I'm saying is, again, yes, you may have situations, you may have to get a little strict with them,
right.
but try to find out what is their strength, pick that up and match it with the frequency of the team.
Sure.
So that's where your true
leader.
Aspect of things in moving into the scaling agile or in any mindset environment would start coming. So just quickly moving on to this aspect, I have how many, 10, 15 minutes?
Yeah.
Okay, I just wanted to cross check because I would accordingly define how much in depth we would go, but at least I would want to bring this point across to the team saying that this is one of the books, the book name is Switch, Change, and it is written by Chip and Dan Heal. So it has really good, at least I have read it multiple times, and it has good examples, good situations being explained of how you can utilize the situations to the best of your own, I would say your own benefit, and get a win-win situation for everybody. So these examples and things would definitely help you get in the things. How many parts of the brain? We have two, right? Left and right. Which is the rational one?
Left.
Left is rational.
Yeah.
And right is the?
Emotion.
Creative emotion.
Imagination. Is that right? So I'm just trying to find out. I put it on the slide. I will be corrected. So.
Actually, I answered that by right brain.
That is answered by, okay, you answered it by the right brain. So the right brain is the emotion and the left is the logic.
Logic, yes.
I'm just trying to figure out. Okay, so the key concept around, as I have said, everything in the mindset change is associated with the two parts of your brain. The rational part, which is reflective, conscious, deliberative, and analytical. And then you have your emotional part, which is instinctive and feels the pain and the pleasure. You're able to see the image, there's an elephant and there's a rider. Now in this book, what they have used as a reference is the elephant and the rider. So the key thing is, the rider is your rational part, who does the analytical, who does the complete analysis and gives a direction of where the elephant, the emotional part goes up. Many times it is also associated with your conscious, subconscious, unconscious mind. But we will not get into those terminologies because that has much more detail. But to stick to the aspect which is being defined in the book, there are two parts, the rational part, the emotional part. Rational is analytical part of it. And the emotional is the part which talks about the instinct and feels pain and pleasure. and to correlate the things, the image that they have used or the references that they have given is, your rational part is your rider, your emotional part is your elephant. So if an elephant has to move in a particular direction, the rider would direct him where to go. The elephant should really feel like going. If he doesn't feel like, he may land into a mess situation. The rider will be down, the elephant might be up or something else. Situations will change. So everyone in your team has both a rider and an elephant. So everybody sitting here has both these aspects in yourself, a rider part and an elephant part. Direct the rider, which is a rational, and motivate the elephant, which is emotional. So the key thing or the framework which is defined in this book is primarily based on these two things, where you're going to direct the rider and you're going to motivate the elephant. So for every individual in your team, you need to be able to figure out the rider aspect and the emotional aspect. And as I said, and most of you have said that appraisal system is changing. This is one of the key things which I feel and I have started implementing in my own teams to make sure that for every individual I'm able to identify what is the rider and what is their elephant. So it becomes easier for us during the appraisal system or during their whole career growth. So as a career growth, these things would really help for an individual to understand. Now, depending on this, this book talks about that there are three aspects which every time get in the way of the elephant or the rider and will not help you achieve the destination or the goal. People problems are often situation problems. Now we took an example, right? We said that we don't know who is honking behind. So my environment is completely gets changed. If everybody starts honking, we get confused, should I really wait or should I move? And in an embarrassing situation, we are like, let's move, let's break the signal and let's just go ahead. So what it says is it's not the people problem. The people problem aspect is really very small. It is the environment which creates lot of issues in your implementation in the organization so as to achieve the goal that you want to define. So if I have to define that I want, say, my revenue of the organization to grow X percentage, I have defined that goal, I have given it to everybody. But if I don't create that kind of an environment, whatever an individual would try to do, it might have its own limitation. So the key aspect which talks about is people problems are often situation problems. So again, going back to everything is most of the time context driven aspect of things. Laziness is often rider exhaustion. Now in this I would like to take an example. How many meetings in a day do you attend in your office?
6 to 7.
4. So we have 4. You are 6 to 7. Anybody more than 6 to 7 meetings in a day in your own office?
How it is 8 nights.
8 nights. So we have 2 people. Okay, so I'll catch hold of these 2 people. And you have more than 8 to 9? Okay. You have more than 8 to 9. Exhausted. Yeah, so now in this 8 to 9 meetings or 6 to 7 meetings that you have, how many of the meetings do you enjoy? You don't enjoy
them. Normally, 1 to 2 meetings which are a kind of outcome-based meetings, those we enjoy.
Okay.
And typically the group and the remaining meetings are like time wasters.
Time wasters.
Yeah. Because somebody wants to achieve something, they are wasting your time.
Because somebody wants to achieve something, they are wasting your time. But you don't see that you have
any value for it. Me.
Achha, you don't find a value.
By the time you are not the organizer, it is a waste.
Whenever you are not an organizer, it is a waste. That's a general conclusion. I think the others will also be thinking that I am not an organizer, attending Rohit's meeting is a waste. That could also be there.
So this is not a waste of time, right?
Then we are getting both SEUs.
No, no, they are getting benefited with SEUs. So I think you should attach more SEUs. Okay. So in the meetings in which you get bored or you don't have any interest or you don't see any value, what do you do?
Mute.
You still attend them?
Yes.
Mute and just listen.
Smartphone.
Mute and
listen.
Mute and
listen. Smartphone. This is a selective listening.
Smartphone use. Laptop.
Is like, not every part of the discussions which are related to you, but you are being stakeholder. You are on those meetings.
Right.
Then selective listening happens. Selective engagement is there.
Right.
But the remaining part, you ignore.
You ignore it. Okay. So remaining part you ignore. How about you? You said all your meetings you don't enjoy. So
basically, it depends upon that, whatever the calls or the meeting events. But yes, we have to be a little bit attentive during the times for visibility. But still,
okay.
I mean, it is getting closed, we don't know. And it is good for the other
meeting. Okay, another meeting comes up.
Right.
So,
That actually kills the moral of that public participants or the stakeholders. So, obviously, that actually kills the interface. So, probably we need to contact for that very well.
And then take
that. And after 10 minutes, we'll say that we just take up and probably just have a kind of overshoot at the end.
Okay. So, the key reason I was asking is because in most of the meetings, we feel like yell and say stop, but we don't do. And that's where the rider gets exhausted, because your rational part really gets exhausted and you're not able to do it. So that's the blockage which gets in your way. Resistance to change is often a lack of clarity. That's one of the key aspects, that if I have to bring a change in the organization, we don't do it. So in the I was asking my earlier, like just at the beginning of the session, that how many of you believe eating healthy is good? Doing exercise is good? We say we all believe, but what I have also seen in my own practical implementations of things is, yes, I do believe eating healthy is good, but why I am not able to implement is because what is a healthy definition and what all is included in healthy is something which I am really not clear of. I really don't have the clarity, so that's why having a banana is healthy or having an apple is healthy. Or eating some spicy food is healthy, I really don't know. Because depending on my body type, eating a banana may not be good for me. Or eating the spicy food may not be good to me. So that clarity is one key thing, because of which we are not really able to get in and find out the things. So just taking time into the constraint, I would not get into much details of things, but at least I would want to give the overall framework of the switch. The first aspect in the switch talks about you need to direct the rider. So you need to make sure that you're providing crystal clear directions so the rider doesn't spin its wheels. Now the key thing out here is that you need to find out situations and things in your own organization which are working fine. What happens is 90% of the time we focus on the problem and we start cribbing about it more. We say that this is not working, this is not there. For a simple example, the cafeteria food, 90% of the times we keep cribbing for it. The food is not good, the thing is not good, this is not there. But we never take efforts to even figure out what is a small change that I can do, or what is good, at least start implementing that. So that's a key aspect of things. So you need to make sure that you're giving the directions to the rider which are crystal clear. Find out the spots which are working and take that as an example and start exploring it, rather than saying that 90% of the times things don't work, but 10% of the time things are working, pick them and start exploring it. The next is motivate the elephant. So you need to make sure that whoever is the rider, you're able to get the elephant working accordingly. So as I gave my example, if the rider wants the elephant to go to the left, but if the elephant feels that if I shift to the left, I'm going to fall down into the valley, the elephant is not going to do. So though my rational part is saying that I should be doing things more effectively, but if I see a risk in that, as an emotional aspect, I will never be doing that. So try to find out the emotional aspect in your own people, which will try motivating them.